Haven't forgot.
Tomorrow.
I don't know.
thank goodness for this week. It was a beautiful, beautiful week. I was able to get to my fire pit a few times. We got some rain, so my grass isn't mad anymore. Son was trying to bear crawl through the grass last week, and he said, ouch! I said, yeah, man, you got to get up out this. This ain't the normal grass you crawl in. It's been a desert out there. It's been a really, really good week. Hey, we're coming up on a year anniversary. July 2nd, which I think is a Tuesday, it will have been 1 year we all have been together, and I am so excited. This has been an eventful year. It's been very pleasant, been awesome. You guys have rejuvenated, re-energized me in so many different ways. I told you I wasn't going to change too much in 1 year, but we heading into year two, and I'm about to push the mess out of you, okay? We're going to hit the ground running. I am so excited. God has some visions and some things that we are going to do because Memorial United Methodist Church, we are on a collision course with the destiny that God has called us to get in line with. So I am grateful for you guys. This year has been amazing. My wife enjoys coming to church. My son was mad because I was in the office without him. That's how much he enjoys coming to church. You guys have made that possible. And I'm so grateful for you in every single way. This year has been absolutely spectacular. Well, good morning, and thank you all for joining us here today. Memorial United Methodist Church, 26 North Locust Street, West Carrollton, Ohio. My name is Jeremiah Lewis. I am senior pastor, for those of you that don't know. And I'm excited to take you on this journey to find out who you are in Jesus Christ. For those of you joining us online, Miss Winnie, I see you. You've been doing amazing. Yeah, I told you I was going to give her a shout out. All right, she's probably on there laughing right now. We're going to have an amazing time together today. And with that, announcements.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Being a holiday week, there's not a whole lot going on here this week, but a few things that we need to talk about. First of all, food pantry, which normally operates Tuesday morning, and I don't know if this is picking me up or not. Okay. Tuesday morning and Thursday evening is closed this week. So we'll be people who comes and helps with that, you got the week off. We've been announcing here for a couple weeks about an event that's going to happen July the 16th. The Premier Health Mobile Unit will be at the church to provide free health screenings for anyone in the community. The plan is to provide these screenings once per quarter, and that's really a nice thing to have, and we really appreciate that they're doing that. The hours for that will be 9 a.m. to 11:30, and if you're interested in knowing more about it, back here on the usher's table, there are these little things that tell you pretty much what I just told you, but maybe a few other things too. Coming up, not this week, but on July the 13th will be our second Saturday program from 4:30 to 6:30. So we're looking forward to that. Invite all the children in the church and in the neighborhood who would like to come to that to be involved. A couple meetings coming up, not this week, but again, later on this month, the Finance Committee will be meeting on July the 16th, and that is a change from our normal time. We normally meet the second Tuesday of the month, but that will be the third Tuesday of the month, so we had to do that for some of the key people who were going to be gone on the second Tuesday. And then Ad Council will meet on Thursday, July 18th this month, and that will be here, and that's a normal meeting time for us. So that's all I have, unless there are others who have announcements and want to call to my attention. Okay. Our opening hymn is Here I Am, Lord, and that is found on 593 in the hymnal. Stand if you're able. Sorry. Yeah, thank you. I've done this for a while. I guess I have to practice. We're going to have the call to worship. Please join me. So many things draw us away from God.
We are tempted by trinkets and gadgets.
We place our interest in temporal things.
Christ calls us to a higher level.
We are called to focus our lives on living as God would have us live.
We are called to be willing to face service and compassion.
Amen. Now, the opening hymn is Here I Am, Lord. That's fine in 593 in your hymnal. Stand if you're able.
Love that song. Our foundation scripture will come from 2 Corinthians 8, verses 7 through 15. 2 Corinthians 8, verses 7 through 15. But since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in the love we have kindled in you, See that you also excel in the grace of giving. I am not commanding you, but I want to test the serenity of the sincerity of your love by comparing it with the earnestness of others. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich. And here is my judgment about what is best for you in this matter. Last year, you were the first not only to give, but also to have the desire to do so. Now finish the work, so that your eager willingness to do it may be matched by your completion of it, according to your means. For if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. Our desire is not that others might be relieved while you are hard-pressed, but that there might be equality. At the present time, your plenty will supply what they need, so that in turn, their plenty will supply what you need. The goal is equality. As it is written, the one who gathered much did not have too much, and the one who gathered little did not have too little. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Our next hymn will be hymn 354, I Surrender All.
Trust him in his presence daily. Okay, maybe we need to go over this one more time.
Do we have to?
Well, sweetie, I don't know if you're getting a good grasp of the ratios here.
Fine.
Okay, all right, step by step. Before we spend any money, what's the first thing that we do?
Give to God.
Good. And why do we do that?
Because he first loved and gave to us.
Good. Good, good, good. Okay, great. Now, the second jar here is for so many different things.
Hold on.
What?
God lives in heaven, right?
Yeah, he lives in heaven.
And heaven has streets paved with gold, right?
Streets paved with gold. Sure, yes.
So why does he need my money if I don't even have a job?
Okay, all right, so good question. So basically when we give to God, we're giving to the church.
So the church gives the money to God?
No, the church keeps the money.
Oh, does God know about this?
Yes, he basically built the system, yeah.
Okay, good.
Okay. See, sweetie, as you grow up, there is nothing better than giving back to God. In the Bible, it's the only place God says, test me on this. When it comes to your money, he says, test me. It's almost like he's saying, I dare you. And your mom and I, we do just that. Even when things are tough, we always give the first part of our money back to God. And then the church takes that money and does all kinds of things to make God famous, like camps and mission trips and even VBS that you love so much, and even helps out people that are in need. You can't outgive God. And when God says test and you do it, he will come through every single time.
Okay, Dad, I get it. I do have one question, though.
Okay.
Why do we need to test God if he already knows all the answers?
That's good. Let me just retrace my steps here, just for a minute.
Kids do have a way of stumping you, don't they? Oh my goodness. My son asked me some train questions the other day. I said, yo, you're on your own, man. I can't. Dad, what's in a steam locomotive? At this point, you know more than I do, son. We're going to spend a nice amount of our time in 2 Corinthians. And to give us some insight on the book of 2 Corinthians, we're going to go back to our root verse, 2 Corinthians 8, 7 through 15. But to give you some notes on 2 Corinthians, it was written in 60 AD, probably by Philippi, after the events of Acts. It is the 47th book of the Bible, 13 chapters, 257 verses, 6,092 words, 29 questions, 4 Old Testament prophecies, 4 New Testament prophecies, 249 verses of history, 4 verses of unfulfilled, and 4 verses of fulfilled prophecy. Paul is the author, and the theme is to comfort those who had repented through, though is rebuked and correction, through his rebuke and corrections in the first epistle, to instruct concerning Christian ministry, to teach the grace of giving and giving instructions concerning the collections for the poor saints in Judea, to vindicate his apostleship and to warn the disobedient. Paul wrote this letter mainly to defend the authority of his teaching about Christ. The church at Corinth was struggling. And one of its problems was the presence of members who openly challenged Paul's authority. These challengers slandered Paul's character and questioned the message he preached. They also introduced several dangerous false teachings. Since the believers in Corinth had come to faith through Paul's ministry, this put the entire church at risk. The false teachers claimed that following the Jewish laws were a requirement for salvation. To counteract this false teaching, Paul emphasized the truth that God changes us from the inside out. We cannot change ourselves by changing our external behavior. As we are reconciled to God, he transforms us into entirely new people. Our old selves are fundamentally changed. Of course, change is never easy. When it involves our lifestyles, old habits die hard, and positive habits have a habit of falling prey to neglect. Typically, the habits that die the hardest are our unhealthy and negative thoughts, as well as self-sabotaging behavior patterns. How many of us have heard the phrase, out with the old and in with the new? Sounds simple, don't it? But even as we long for an end to our old bad habits, we cling to them. Thankfully, God has done something about our helpless situation. That is why we can admit our powerlessness and come to Him for help. It is essential to our recovery that we turn our lives over to God. Through Christ's death and resurrection, God made it possible for us to experience the changes we long for. By being reconciled with Him, we can have new life in Christ, transformed from the inside out. Transformed from the inside out. I've been fooled by some individuals who transformed the outside, but they were no different on the inside, right? A new car can change the look, but it can't change the person. Amen? A suit can change the look. A haircut can change the look. I feel fresh myself, but it doesn't change the person. I ain't been to my barber in like a month and a half. He said, man, I thought I lost a client, right? The outward appearance, you know, you can put on some makeup, you can get your hair done, you can get your nails done. The outward appearance, it counts for a number of things, but the outward doesn't change the inward. The inward changes the outward. We must turn our lives to God in order for our inward to change, for our recovery, for our growth, for our transformation, to end our unhealthy thoughts, unhealthy thoughts and unhealthy and self-sabotaging behavior. This is why we turn our lives to God. Very few places do we need to turn our minds and actions over to God for than the church and what the church does, right? Let's look at 2 Corinthians 8, verses 8 through 9. I am not commanding you, but I want to test the sincerity of your love by comparing it with the earnestness of others. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich. Verse 8, to test your serenity, your sincerity, to test your sincerity, right? How honest are you? How sincere are you? How authentic are you? To test your sincerity. Few other places test our sincerity, like the church, and specifically giving to the church. You know, we've heard all the conversations we see on the news points out a number of negative things. We know the pastors that got a helipad in their parking lot and they hop in that mug to leave and they hop, like we know that stuff. The amazing part is that too often our minds are set on the small percentage of things that happen and not set on the majority, right? So we see those images and they get blasted to us. So now we think, man, all churches are trying to get rich. I'm driving a 2017 Kia Optima, right? That mug needs brake, it needs rotors. Thank God the AC still works, right? I'm hopping in that mug in 97 degree heat. My car is telling me it's 102 in there. My AC is still good. I'm not trying to get rich off the church, right? I'm not. They got to remind me that we're tax exempt. I'm not driving anything special. I got this shirt on clearance. Like, what are we talking about right now? Right? Man, I hit up a sale at the Nike factory the other day. I was grateful. Come on, man. So we have to get rid of those unhealthy images. And it's amazing how when we internalize some unhealthy images about a few things, it's easy for us to internalize those about all things. Right? Through a couple situations, I hear individuals say, all men are dogs. Not all men, just the men you choose to be around, right? Not all men, right? Because we could easily, as men, say all women are cats, but we don't do that. If you have a cat, you know cats come around when they want something. I'm not going to dig too much deeper into that one, right? But we have to get rid of those unhealthy visuals, those unhealthy habits, right? We are at an amazing church that does amazing things. You want to know how this church is amazing? Because if it wasn't, you wouldn't be here, right? There are a million things you could be doing on a Sunday. Some of y'all could be replanting some of your seeds. Some of y'all could be watching stuff on TV. I don't know what you guys would do on a Sunday, right? But you guys chose to be here. That means there's something good going on in this church. There's a paradox that if you are mentally, emotionally, and spiritually unhealthy, you will struggle. We give not because we are loaded, because we give because we know that it will be given back, right? Luke 6:38 says, "Give and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you." Amen. Too often we are fighting to keep what we have. You can't receive or give with a closed fist. You can't. And we are in a society, man, look, every dollar counts. We are living in a society today that every dollar counts. So the challenge is, how do we make every dollar count? Well, one thing my family does, we have the budget conversation. We have it. We have to have it. Why? Because I don't know about you, but Netflix has raised its prices about 3-4 times. Right? It has. And if you're not paying attention, you're going to click on the okay, and then all of a sudden that's an extra $5 coming out of your account. So now what was once $10 has now turned into $15, and now what's $15 has now turned into $20. But too often we don't pay attention to those things. When you get that 7-day free trial, if you're not paying attention, that 7-day free trial now turns into a subscription. So you now have things coming out of your bank account that you haven't counted on. But when you budget, when you go back through, you can now say, you know what? I'm going to cut that off. I'm going to cut that off. I'm going to cut that off. Oh, there goes $150. That is the truth. These budget conversations are difficult. And when you're in a relationship, when you're married, or when you're, you know, when you're trying to figure out how to best fortify your finances, that budget conversation is big. And not only the subscription stuff that comes out, but how much money we spend on fast food. I know, it gets me too. Right? It's a lot. If we calculated that, we're probably spending $100 to $150 a week just on fast food. That's 15 times going to the fast food spot. Some of us go for breakfast, some of us go for lunch, and we might just go for dinner, right? And it may not be every day. My wife and I, we've made it a point to cook, right? We've made it a point to cook. We'll find, man, steaks are always on sale at Kroger. Man, that stuff been on sale. Salmon is on sale. And half the time when we cook it at home, it tastes better than it did at the restaurants. I don't know if you've been in restaurants lately. Some of them places have gone downhill. Yeah. Yes. There's been some places, man, I ain't eating that. But you just, did my son go in the back and make this? Right? So we've learned to maximize our bank accounts, and that's come from difficult conversations because we want to be able to be a blessing as well. In order to do that, you have to understand what's going in, and you also have to understand as well what's going out. Correct? To be able to give, because I also want to be able to receive. But how can you receive with the fist? To receive, you have to open your hand. You have to give over your reason to not. And too often we give a reason to not give, but we don't create a reason to give. We too often have a reason not to do something when God is asking us to. We have too many reasons to not, and we ain't found a reason to. If you need a reason to give, and I'm not talking about every church on the block, I'm talking about specifically this one, right? This is the church that we are a part of. I'm talking specifically this one. If you look up food pantries in West Carrollton, our church is the first church that comes up. Come on, man. If I'm gonna give to anything, that's a good reason to give. That is a good reason to give. We have been serving almost 200 families a month
a month. That's households. We're not counting per person. We're counting households. There may be 2 to 3 people in those households. So that may be 600 people we're giving to a month. That is amazing. Some of those individuals we see once a month. Some individuals we may see once. And that one time they come into the food pantry may be what they needed to give them the pick-me-up to be able to make it over the hump, amen? And guess where they came? They came here. They came here. That is a really good reason to give. Not only do we have a food pantry here, we've been doing AA down here for, what, about 50-plus years? Man, recovery is so important. This church is beautiful, and individuals have been meeting at this beautiful church for the past 50 years. When you give, not only are you giving to the food pantry, but you are giving to help keep the lights on and so that we can help house some of these individuals that are, programs that are coming in here. Man, look, this place is packed on a Thursday. Have y'all come here on a Thursday and seen how many individuals show up for AA? We got bikes out in this we got motorcycles out there. I thought we was having a motorcycle rally one day. I walked out there like, man, look, this was nice. I had to tell my son not to touch nothing. And people are protective of their motorcycles, right? Amen. He's like, bike. I said, boy, get over here. Then we have motorcycles all the way down the street. And they're coming to our church, right? Our church. They're coming to our church, this building. Even though we are not here, we still got stuff going on. Amen. Because I've been to some churches that ain't got nothing going on. Right? People don't even want to show up on Sunday. We got people showing up Sunday, Tuesday, Thursday. I'm in the building every day. Come on, man. We got a lot of stuff going on in this church. We got second Saturday. Man, look, those kids have an amazing time second Saturday. I love pulling up on Sundays and seeing the chalk that they done drew all over the parking lot. I love seeing that. Right? Because we didn't have little people in the building. That is exciting, right? We are laying the foundation for the next generation. It's your church is doing this. That is exciting. Look, Netflix don't need no more of your money. Second Saturday does. Hulu doesn't need any more of your money. The food pantry does, right? We done paid so much of these subscription services and ain't even got the stuff on there you really want to watch. Let's be honest.
I ain't talking to nobody today.
Half the time we work so much, we can't even enjoy that stuff. We end up watching YouTube, TikTok, or something, and then going to sleep. That stuff is free, if we being honest. Oh, Lord. Then also, when you give, we are part of the United Methodist denomination, which means we are a part of UMCOR. Whenever there is a natural disaster, UMCOR is usually the first to the disaster. So when you give, you are giving to aid other countries and even America. Whenever there's a disaster, UMCOR is there. That is a good return on some money. I don't know about you. Because I've thrown some stuff in a hole and like, man, I hope it turns out to be something. 2 Corinthians 9:7, it says, each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. 2 Corinthians 9:7, each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. God loves a cheerful giver. God loves a cheerful giver, not out of compulsion. We do a lot of stuff out of compulsion. When you do stuff out of compulsion, you're not doing it out of consistency. Right? Too often we just, oh yeah, let's do that. But it's not consistency. When you really love doing something, what are you going to do? You're going to do it consistently. You love your garden, man. When it was dry outside, some of y'all was out there every day. You ain't going to die on me, little one. Right? Talking to your plants and stuff. I got my hand up like I'm out there. I don't even know what I'm doing right now. What is it? What is this? This ain't even an unguard. I don't know what's happening right now. Yep. How did y'all handle me for a year? I just been up here having a good old time. But consistency, right? Consistency, not compulsion. when you do things out of compulsion, it's a one-time thing or whatever it is, and it's okay sometimes if you're given to a good thing. But when you really love something, it is consistency. It is continued over and over and over again. I know my God has been consistent with me. That consistent grace, that consistent mercy. When I haven't asked for it, grace has been given to me. When I was in the wrong, God has given me mercy. The judgment that I should have cast on me, God's like, no, you asked for forgiveness and I forgave you. That is a consistent thing. Our God is consistent. So why aren't we consistent with our God? Many of us, we would love to give. We just haven't. It just slips to the back of our mind. I need you to put it at the forefront of your mind, because whether you know it or not, these are some of the items that our individuals are getting. Yeah, you're going to get a little illustration today. And then you're going to have to follow me, Kathy, because I'm coming down here. Yeah, I'm coming down. I guess I'll come up here. Hopefully nobody get too mad on you. So people get bread. Man, the price of bread has gone up. Correct? I remember bread was 99 cents, and not the hard stuff you could throw out the wall. I mean the good stuff, the sunbeam, the one with got the young lady eating it on the cup. Like, this was good stuff, man. People get bread. You can do a lot of stuff with bread. Irish Spring. There ain't nothing stronger than an Irish Spring. This stuff right here has withstood the test of time, right? You can put on Irish Spring and smell good for two whole days, right? It's what they getting. They getting the good. Man, I can smell it out of the box. It's good. This is some of the stuff that they're getting, right? They're getting cereal. Cereal is expensive. You talk about growing up and being an adult. When I had to buy groceries for the first time, I'm like, man, Kix is $5? Are you serious? They getting cereal, right? They get jelly. They get these little squishy toys. These things are so adorable. I love them. They have, you know, kids come in. We give them these type of things, right? Because they're individuals that come to the food pantry and they have their babies. I've seen multiple individuals come to the food pantry and they have their little ones. So Brian's walking around just as ADHD as he can be. Hey, little man, how you doing? And he's just, you know, handing stuff. He loves handing stuff out. Hey, you got cats? Guess what? We got cat food. Because even though individuals are struggling, they still got animals. Right? Your dog, your cat still has to eat. We have cat food down there. Now, we out of dog food because we got a community of dog lovers, but we got cat food down there. Ugh. Mac and cheese. Rice. Man, look, they spoiled down there. Not only do they have the spaghetti holes, they got the spaghetti halves. It's that good stuff right here. It's good right here. This is what individuals are leaving our food pantry with, right? If you have little ones, they got the Pediasure. We got multiple types of Pediasure. Why? Because not only do the babies need a stuffed animal, the babies need to eat too. So these little babies are getting food. We got, man, ravioli, beef ravioli. I don't know about you, but I used to pop this stuff out the can as a kid, put it in a bowl, pop it in a microwave, and I'm good. Right? I'm good. Ain't nothing like some canned ravioli. Love this stuff. Look, there have been movies about what happens if we run out of coffee. It's called a zombie apocalypse. I heard a scientist say one time, he was doing an interview. He said, man, I didn't drink coffee for 90 days as an experiment. And he said it was terrible. Terrible. They said, when did you feel better? When I started drinking coffee again. And with no way to curb it. Like, look, they get coffee, man. Coffee beans. Yes. Sun-kissed, chunky light tuna. How many of us like a good tuna sandwich in this mug? Yes. You get the Jiffy mix, toothbrushes. We have personal items for individuals. Come on, man. Look, life happens. Don't look too hard. Put that back in the box. There's no way. But these are just some of the things. I didn't even go to the freezer section that we got. Somebody in their will wrote us into their will, and they donated part of their will for us getting freezers downstairs. So our freezers are packed downstairs. We have multiple refrigerators downstairs for the only food pantry in West Carrollton. This is just a fraction of the stuff that we have for individuals. They leave with almost $200 worth of food. Isn't that worth giving to? And I will say this, because you guys are my family, and I told y'all this year I'm gonna challenge you, we've had to make some cuts. So individuals would come and they would usually get this and get that just so that we're not being a burden on you all. We've cut some things that we would give in the food pantry because we don't want to be a burden on you. But why do we have to cut anything? We shouldn't have to cut anything. It is the reality that if we have 80 people coming to church, only 10% are tithing. That means out of that 80, only 8 are giving. 8. And I'm not saying this to guilt you. I'm not saying this to shame you. But out of the 80 people that have been here, God's been good to all of us. God's been good to all of us. And I will never tell you to do something that I haven't done myself. My wife and I have the budget conversation, not only to make sure that our money's right, but also to make sure we can give. Because there have been moments where we've had to utilize a food pantry. Any of y'all ever had to utilize a food pantry? You ain't got to show your hand or nothing like that. I ain't trying to embarrass you like that. But we all have been in situations where we were in need of something. And now some of us in here, we ain't sitting the best, but we sitting better than where we were a number of years ago. Now it's the time for you to say, you know what? It's time for me to give back. If I can't be there in person, you're going to get my dollars. You're going to get my support so that we can have the shelves full in our food pantry. So families can show up and say, you know what, I want this, I want that, because they're grateful for what they have, but I would love for this church to have the best food pantry in Ohio. I would love that. I would love for the news to come to our church, man. People are excited about coming to the Memorial United Methodist Food Pantry. That's our food pantry. It's ours. And you all have stepped up to the plate continually. I've been challenging the mess out of y'all, and guess what? You guys have risen to the occasion. We once had a number of individuals who were serving from the community in the church. We didn't have very many individuals in the church serving in the food pantry. Guess who's the majority serving in the food pantry now? Individuals from this congregation. Because you guys have taken ownership. You guys have stepped up to the plate. You guys have said, you know what? I ain't got to go somewhere else and do outreach. I can do outreach in my own building. Hallelujah. That means you guys have stepped up to the plate. You guys have said, I will serve my time. And it's a difficult conversation to have about serving with our money. This is not an easy conversation to have. Because many of us, we are tight. We are struggling here. We are struggling there. But when we budget and we figure out where we can do this and we can do that, then we can create an impact for families. We may never meet these individuals, but guess what? We just treated these individuals to a God experience with what we said. You know what, God? I'm going to give this. I'm going to give this, and I'm not going to give it compulsively. It's not a one-time deal. I'm going to give it over and over and over and over and over and over again. God, I'm going to test you, because for some reason, we call on God for just about everything, and then we look, nope, God, you're not going to get my money. But when we need our money to stretch, who do we call on? We call on God, and God gives. God gives. If we did the math, if you gave $10 a month, you could feed one household. If you gave $10 a month, I'm not asking you to give $10 a month. I'm asking you to give above and beyond. I'm challenging you. In the Bible, in some texts, it says we give 10%. I've been looking forward. I'm not about preaching, going into the weeds and stuff like that. Traditionally, in my family, we've given 10%. So I was raised on that. So that's what I give. I give 10%. It comes right out of my paycheck because I'm a spender. So if I see it, it's going to go somewhere else. I'm just being honest, right? Shoot. So it comes directly out of my paycheck. I don't need to see it. I don't need to see it. I just need to know that it's going to where it's supposed to be at. If you get on the memorial website, you can choose where you would like to give. If you want to give to the food pantry, if you want to give to the general fund is where we take money out to pay for pizza for this or do this and do that for a number of individuals. Like, you can choose where you give. And you can also choose when it comes out. right? If you know your check hits on the 30th, you can program it for the 30th to come out. You're 10%. I'm challenging you to give. Give the best you possibly can, right? Many of us were sitting in a good situation right now. It ain't the best, but we are good, and we are better than we once were. Now is the time to act. We have a great church that does a number of amazing, amazing, amazing things. 2 Corinthians 8, 14 through 15 says, at the present time, your plenty will supply what they need. Amen? At the present time, your plenty will supply what they need. We have plenty, whether we know it or not. We live in America. We have plenty. I had some comments, but I'm going to keep those to myself. If y'all watch what I watched this week, it's terrifying. 2 Corinthians 8, 14 through 15, at the present time, your plenty will supply what they need, so that in turn, their plenty will supply what you need. Our needs are different. Our needs are different for each person in this room, but guess what? Your plenty will supply what they need, and their plenty will supply what you need. The goal is equality. As it is written, the one who gathered much did not have too much, and the one who gathered little did not have too little. Thank God that I don't have too much, right? What happens when we get too much? We start to do some things we probably shouldn't do. God knows us. Thank God I don't have too much. I have just enough. Thank God I have just enough. I have just enough. I'm grateful for my just enough. And with my just enough, I'm going to give so that I can supply. Equality. We have a number of individuals that come to the church, they come to the food pantry, and we don't judge them for what they drove in. We don't. There are many individuals on a fixed income, right? Some people before retirement, they got the car they wanted, they paid it off before they retired, then they retired, so they roll up with a Lexus. It's fine by me, right? You still got a fixed income. I'm not gonna judge you on what you have or what you don't have. Some individuals do pickups for other individuals. We have youth that serve in our food pantry. We have young people that are coming to our food pantry and serving. These are teenagers that have said, you know what, I could be playing video games, but I'm gonna go spend some time serving. These are the things that our church does. These are the things that our church does, and I am so grateful for what our church has been able to do. Luke 6:38, it says, give and it will be given to you, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be poured into your lap, for with the measure you use, it will be measured unto you. I think about God challenging us, right? With the measure you use, it will be measured unto you. So if you give much, guess what? Much will be given to you, right? If you give much, much will be given to you. If you give a little will be given unto you. But I do know that we serve a God that gives us regardless. But guess what? I want much in my life. Man, I want it to be poured into my lap. I want God to open that window of heaven and say, there you go. Hey, and you know what? I want it for you all too. Have you all been blessed? Oh my goodness. Some of you were sitting on your deathbed and God said, not now. Now, some of you were in a very rotten situation and God chose to bless you with something that you could not give yourself, whether it be a job that God, the door that God opened that no man could open and also no man could close. Come on now. God blessed with a situation that you thought wouldn't be possible, but oh my goodness, God blessed. We serve a blessing God, and I am a cheerful giver because I know how blessed I am. I need you guys to be cheerful givers because you know how blessed you are. You know where you could be without God, and you know where you are with God's blessing. You have relationships that you wouldn't have had because of God. You should be a cheerful giver because of that. Some of y'all have kids. Come on, man. The doctor said you couldn't. Guess what? It happened anyway. You need to be a cheerful giver. Some of y'all have an amazing job that puts up with your stuff. You should be a cheerful giver. Come on, man. I don't look at the why not. I don't look at the no, I'm not. I look at the yes, I can. The yes, I can. I can give. We all are struggling in our own ways. This is not an easy conversation to have, but I'm challenging you guys because I know there's a number of you in here who are doing better than you were before, and that is only because of God. The grace and mercy of God. And now we have an opportunity to show that grace and that mercy to individuals who show up. To the individuals who show up, and I've met a number of them. Great people, individuals come in with humility. I've seen individuals come in and they're crying, and we just make sure they know, hey, don't be embarrassed, don't be ashamed. Your family here. We have the Monday program, individuals serving Tuesdays and Thursdays. The Monday program is a reentry program. Individuals who have, you know, served their time, they give them the tools to be able to, once they get released, they can actually do better and be better. So our church is doing multiple things at once. That's a blessing. That's a blessing. That's a blessing. We are hope for the hopeless. We are a place that individuals can find refuge. Amen. We are doing that. I want to encourage you guys, don't look at what you don't have, look at what you have. You have an opportunity, and I'm not asking you to do something that I don't do myself. But it's worth it. To be pressed down, shaken together. I love testing God, because God show up and show out. Hey, God, I'm going to test you, man. All right. All of a sudden, you ask for something, and the prayer come your way just like that. That's because you've been given. And many of us, we give out of a deficit, right? We are asking God, and we, you know, we're in the red. Man, I'm trying to be in the green. God, I'm asking, and I know I've been given, I've been faithful. I need you to bless. And God has blessed all of us. Now it's our time to be a blessing. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, that our plenty will supply what is needed. Our plenty. God, because we have plenty. We may have to reshuffle the deck. May have to have a budget conversation. We may have to actually cook our cheeseburger. God, we may actually have to buy the ice cream instead of going to the ice cream shop and getting the three scoops. We actually have to scoop it ourselves, God. We may actually have to buy the coffee grounds and make our own coffee and realize it's actually more delicious than when we get it from the coffee shop, God. God, we thank you for showing us the ways we can simplify our life, God, because we've complicated our budgets. We've complicated our lives, God. We thank you for the simplicity and the opportunity to give. God, there are some individuals that can't give because they just don't have. But I know this church. I know these individuals in this church, God. They have to give. God, they have it to give. And God, we thank you for working with their minds, working with their hearts, working with their habits, God, that we won't have to cut anything else out of the budget for the food pantry, that the food pantry will have more than enough, that we can go do the pickups, that we can go grab what we need in bulk for this community that comes to us, whether we have it or not, God. And we thank you that this church, as it's done for the past year that I've been here, has risen to the occasion, God. God, you have strengthened us. You've given us joy. You've re-energized us, God. And we accept the challenge, God, to budget better, to give 10% and above to make sure that our community continues to know who we are, to continue to keep the doors open for AA, for our grief recovery, God, for the food pantry, for Second Saturday. God, we thank you that our plenty will be enough. God, because you've blessed us so much. You've given us so much. Thank you, Lord, that we intentionally make the time to make sure that money comes out of our account, God, because you deserve our best. You don't deserve our seconds. You don't deserve the leftovers. You deserve the best because you gave us the best when you sent your son to die on the cross for us. We haven't forgotten about that. You found us when we weren't trying to be looked for. You gave us opportunities that we didn't deserve, that we didn't earn. You have us sitting next to individuals that love us for who we are and not what we can give, God. We thank you for that. We don't deserve it, but you gave it anyway. So you deserve the best we can give. God, we thank you. We thank you that when we, as we move into this 4th of July, this independence time, God, we understand the freedoms that we have in America. The freedom to give, the freedom to worship. And God, the freedom to show that you are and will always be the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, and this America is lost without you. God, we thank you that we will be the conduits of it. With what we have, we give. We ask for all of these things. In your mighty name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is hymn 467, Trust and Obey. Trust and Obey. Ephesians 3:20-21. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine, according to the power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Church, I love you. God loves you. Nothing you can do about that. Oh, it's been a wonderful year. Let's go.